Please stand for the call to worship. It was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. On this children's Sabbath, we gather to praise God, who created every wonderful child. People were bringing little children to Jesus in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid hands on them, and blessed them. We gather to follow Christ, who cherished the children others would keep away. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. We gather to be moved by the Spirit, that we might be partners in the end of the oppressed.
Thank you. The Apostle Paul said, I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inmost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? And then he says, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord, meaning that Jesus is the one who can save us. As we confess, let us join together. God of all, we confess that we love too few and too little. We fail to glimpse your image in each and every child. We cherish our own children, but don't value others. We keep silent when children's needs cry out for help. O God, in your tender mercy, open our eyes to see every child as a reflection of you. Open our hearts to cherish each child as we would love our own. Open our mouths to speak your word of justice, to protect children in harm's way. These things we pray as your imperfect but precious children, in the name of your beloved child, Jesus. In the name of the one who can save us, amen. Friends, God is faithful and just when we confess our sin and may be trusted to forgive us of every kind of wrong. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Prepare our hearts for the hearing of God's word. Let us pray. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us listen for God's word to us today in the Psalms. The Lord is King, let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned upon the cherubim, let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion, he is exalted over the peoples. Let them praise your great and awesome name, holy is he. Mighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Extol the Lord our God, worship at his footstool, holy is he. Moses and Aaron are among his priests. Samuel also was among those who called on his name. They cried to the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them in the pillar of cloud. They kept his decrees and the statutes that he gave them. O Lord our God, you answered them. You were a forgiving God to them, but an avenger of their wrongdoings. Extol the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to I'd now like to invite all the children forward. You can come sit here on the steps. We're going to have a little conversation, and then you get front row seats to a baptism. Hi, Grayson. Got a good group here. All right. Good to see everybody. Just a quick note, if you're singing with the KIC choir right after the baptism, if you want to come sit in this pew over here so you'll be ready to go for your next spot. But glad to have everybody here. This is a special Sunday. We're calling it the Children's Sabbath, and we're talking a lot about children. And you know what? You happen to be children, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, you are. You have a crayon. That's going to be explained later, but you can use it to color as well. But there's something else going on this Sunday, and I just mentioned it earlier. Can you guess what? What was it? A baptism. What's this over here? Have you seen this before? This is our baptismal font. You know what's inside?
Water.
That's right. What do you use water for? You drink it. Baptize babies with it. You take baths in it. That's right. What else do we do? In big bathtubs. That's right. Water's really important, isn't it? We use it every day of our lives. We need it to drink. We need it to live. And we need it to clean ourselves. So it's actually a really good image when we baptize with water, because God cleans us. God makes us new. And when we do baptisms, we are telling everybody that God loves us. God loves each and every one of you. And we're going to have a new little baby who's going to come up here in just a few moments, and we're going to baptize him. But what I want you to do is, I have a feeling a lot of you have been baptized. Maybe not all of you. But what we're called to do when we watch baptisms is we're remembering our own baptisms. Perhaps you were too young to remember it, like I was. I don't remember my baptism. I was just a little tiny baby. But we can remember by watching others. And then we all make a promise to support one another. So we're going to do the baptism, and you guys have front row seats to watch, okay? So I'll invite Cynthia Ford, and we'll invite the Judson family forward. Mind holding this for me? Thank you. And you guys can come stand right here. You have the family support, and if you want to head on up to the lectern, we'll get ready. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority on heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and remember I am with you always to the end of the age. Hear also these words from Holy Scripture. The promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls. Obeying the word of our Lord Jesus and confident of his promises, we baptize those whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show that we belong to God. God frees us from sin and death, uniting us with Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. Let us remember with joy our own baptism as we celebrate this sacrament.
On behalf of the session, I present Cyrus William Judson, son of Nikki and Michael Judson, to receive the sacrament of baptism.
Nikki and Michael, in presenting Cyrus for baptism, you announce your faith in Jesus Christ, and that you want your son to study him, know him, love him, and serve him as his chosen disciple. Do you desire that Cyrus be baptized? If so, say we do. Relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to your child? If so, please say we do.
Our Lord Jesus Christ ordered us to teach those who are baptized. Do you, the saints of the church, promise to tell this new disciple the good news of the gospel, to pray for him, and by your fellowship to strengthen his ties with the family of God, so that he will someday profess faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Do you?
We do. Through baptism, we enter the covenant God has established. Within this covenant, God gives us new life, guards us from evil, and nurtures us in love. In embracing that covenant, we choose whom we will serve by turning from evil and turning to Jesus Christ. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, therefore, Nikki and Michael, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? Do you? Will you be Christ's faithful disciples, obeying his word and showing his love? If so, please respond with, I will, with God's help.
All right, Cyrus, we're getting to you. We haven't forgotten you. We haven't forgotten. Our God nourishes and sustains all living things through the gift of water. Part of baptism is to serve as a reminder of our story of faith. Cyrus, for you, in the beginning of time, God's Spirit moved over the watery chaos, calling forth order and life. For you, in the time of Noah, God destroyed evil by the waters of the flood, giving righteousness a new beginning. For you, God liberated Israel out of slavery through the waters of the sea into the freedom of the promised land. And it was for you that Jesus was baptized by John in the waters of the Jordan and anointed by the Holy Spirit. And by the baptism of his own death and resurrection, Christ set us free from sin and death and opened the way to eternal life. This was all for you, little guy. This is your story. This is our story. But yet, there's no possible way that you're going to remember anything I just said to you. And so we promise to tell you this, our story. Let us join together in prayer. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us. As we baptize with water, baptize us with the Holy Spirit. Remind us that we are all your children, and that you love us, that you hold us, and that you bless us. We thank you for the water of baptism, and we pray your touch upon it now, through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right, Cyrus, let's see how you do. You ready? Hi, bud. Got him. All right, you see the baby, guys? He's about to get wet. He doesn't know what's going to hit him. Yeah, you smile at them? Okay. He liked the part about getting wet. By what name are we baptizing him? Cyrus William Judson. All right. Cyrus William Judson, you are a very special child of God, and God loves you very much. I now baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. May the Spirit of the living God fall upon you and live in your heart forevermore. Amen. Friends, we have our newest member, Mr. Cyrus William Judson. Let's give him a nice welcome. Give him a welcome. Say hi. Cyrus, as we walk down here, I want you to remember these faces. These are your Sunday school teachers. These are the people that are going to help your parents raise you. They're going to make sure that you stay on the right path. And they're going to be helpful. They're going to be very helpful, especially when you start crying in the middle of Patrick's sermons. They're going to be kind and give you crayons and things to color. This is your family, and we are so excited to have you be a part of us. You did a great job. He did a great job, don't you think?
Let us pray. Almighty God, giver of life, you have called us by name and pledged to each of us your faithful love. We pray for your child, Cyrus. Watch over him. Guide him as he grows in faith. Give him understanding and a quick concern for neighbors. Help him to be a true disciple of Jesus Christ. We also pray for his parents, Nikki and Michael, Help them to know you, to love with your love, to teach your truth, and to tell the story of Jesus to your child. We pray all this in the name of the one who was baptized, your Son, who is our Savior and risen Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. To remember this day, we have his certificate of baptism as well as a copy of the service so that you can remind him one day of the promises you made on his behalf. And we have his first Bible that we'd like to present to you guys. I'll give it to Dad. Congratulations, and thank you guys. You may have your seat. And guys, thank you for being up here. And if you're singing in the KIC choir, if you want to go sit over there. If you're not, you can head on out. Thank you.
Listen now to reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 1 to 10. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness, of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you because our message of the gospel came to you not only in word, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction, just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake. And you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
1,857 high school students drop out. Public school students are suspended.
2,144 public school students are suspended. Thank you, guys. Appreciate your help. After worship, I would encourage you to come up and you can check out the little glass vase there holding all the grains of rice. For all those statistics that were read, they are staggering when we consider the amount and the number of children who are affected by so many things. And we remember those children in worship today. Let us go to God in prayer once more. Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray your Spirit's continued presence with us now. And we pray that you would silence any voice in us but your own. And Lord, I pray that as my word strays from yours, may it fall away and quickly be forgotten, but may your word, your truth, and your promise remain upon our hearts forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This is the children's Sabbath, and earlier Kayla read for us the passage in 1 Thessalonians. It's the beginning of Paul's letter to the church in Thessalonica. That's a hard word to say, isn't it? Thessalonica. Say that three times fast. But as is typical of Paul and his letters, it starts out with this great salutation, this welcoming and praising the church for their witness, for their example and of their faith. But I'd like to draw your attention to verses 6 through 8. I'm going to read them again, and I want you to listen with perhaps new ears and make note of any words that pop out to you when you hear it. And you became imitators for us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia and in Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and in Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak of it. Were there any phrases, any words that stuck out to you? I was able to ask this at our 8 a.m. service. Few too many people in here to be able to ask the question and hear all your responses. But it was interesting, the words that stuck out to the group first was imitators. The word imitating. Then there was you became an example. And then last there was that phrase that said, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we had no need to speak about it. Let's take that first one, imitators. Imitation. When you hear the word imitation or imitators, what comes to mind? Is it positive or negative? When we asked this at the 8 a.m. service, a lot of our initial responses were actually quite negative. Hearing the word imitator has a negative connotation to it. When we think in the world of business, the last thing you want to do is be an imitator, am I right? Every company wants to be the innovator, the originator, not the imitator. And when it comes to certain products, if you're in the grocery store, and let's say you are a great baker, and you have the choice between imitation vanilla or the real deal, what's better? Well, the reason they have imitation is it's cheaper. But every good baker, if they want to use good ingredients, is always going to go for the real deal. So imitation has this negative imagery to it, but does it always have to be negative? Or can imitation have a positive connotation? How many of you have role models or have had role models at any point in your life? You can raise your hand. I'd venture to say that every single one of us at some point in our life have had role models. Sometimes they're for a season, sometimes they walk throughout most of our journey. Sometimes we don't even realize the role models in our midst. But we learn from our role models, and one of the ways we learn from our role models is by imitating them. They are examples. It's how we begin to learn as children, by imitating. And as followers in Christ, we are invited to imitate Jesus, our Savior. He is an example of a way we should live. He's much more than just an example, but he is an example. We grow and learn the more we imitate our role models, and our actions begin to reflect that. So imitation can be a very good thing as well, but I wonder, how often do we pause to consider who might be imitating us? Have you ever wondered that? Who might be imitating you? Who might be imitating me? Who is watching? This question came to mind recently at home. It's hard to believe, but Micah is going to be turning 2 at the end of this month. And it's just amazing to watch his growth throughout these almost 2 years. He has learned so many different things, and he's now at the age where he wants to help with everything. Have you experienced that before? They want to help with everything. First, he likes to help with the laundry. And how he does this is he imitates Kate as an example as he takes piece by piece, pieces out of the washer and puts them into the dryer. He can only do one at a time, so it takes about 3 times as long. But you don't want to stop him because he's learning, and you see the satisfaction on his face as he helps and participates, and then Kate will often let him push the laundry basket by himself into the living room. One of the other things that's probably by far his most favorite way to help is with the dishwasher. He likes to help empty the dishes. I know I heard some of the parents kind of gasp there, oh goodness. And so I've learned he likes to take pieces out and then hand them to me, and he goes so quick that I just have to empty it out onto the counter, because I don't have time to put it in the cabinets, especially when that little hand is holding up a glass. And perhaps like me, you imagine it just shattering down on the ground. Well, in one instance, we were watching him, and he walked over to the side where all the utensils are kept. You know, I have that separate compartment to wash all the utensils. And he reached in, and I thought he was going to hand something to me, but he grabbed measuring spoons. And then he walked away. And we watched him as he walked over to the proper drawer that opens up over his head, by the way, puts it in, and closes it. Kate and I were flabbergasted. Where did he learn this? Did you teach him? I didn't teach him that. We didn't teach him the proper drawer to put these measuring spoons in. Or so we thought we had not taught him. Someone was watching. Someone is watching us. That's a humbling thought, is it not? Someone is watching us and taking notes and modeling their own behavior after us. I think it's modeled best or said best in a poem I ran across on the internet by Richard Cook entitled Those Little Eyes. And this poem goes like this. Little eyes are watching you each and every day, and little ears are listening to every word you say. Little hands are fast at work doing what you do, and a little mind is dreaming to grow up just like you. To them, you are the wisest. They lean on your every word. They believe in you with all their hearts, and all from you they've heard. When they grow up, they want to be someone just like you. So watch the all of what you say and all the things you do. Little eyes are all around us, gazing in our direction, watching every move, every interaction, every act, every comment that we say. And you need not be a parent for their gaze to turn your way. They are watching as we greet one another with smiles on Sunday morning, and then they're still watching when we turn our backs and roll our eyes. They are watching as We sing and worship and confess our sins. And they're still watching as we shake our fingers at one another in anger. They are watching as we talk about mission and helping those in need. But they're still watching as we sit back merely content to observe. Little eyes are watching everything we do. These are lessons of a lifetime. Are we content with what we have been teaching? Have we forgotten the little eyes around? It's important that we remember these lessons because the sake of the church depends upon it. Just a moment ago, we baptized Cyrus William Judson. And if you remember, we all made a promise to be with Michael and Nikki as they raise their son in the faith. It's something that's not one person's job or two people's job. It is the job of, it says it takes a village. It takes a community. It takes a family. And we made that promise, but you know, Cyrus is not the only one in our midst whom we made that promise, is he? Sitting all around us are children and youth, some with little eyes, some with the eyes of young adults, who we made promises to. How are we helping them? What example are we displaying? The sake of our world, the sake of the church depends upon it. I once heard it best quoted this way: the church is always only one generation away from extinction. The church is only one generation away from extinction. If we are unable to pass the baton, to pass the faith, to pass the mantle of leadership, then who will? We need to support our children. We need to support our youth. Are we aware that they are our hope? Sitting among us are our future leaders, or our future politicians, our lawmakers, clergy, doctors. The list goes on. Our hope sits all around us. So on this Children's Sabbath, we strive to remember to be better examples, if not for ourselves, then especially for the eyes that watch us. Let us pray. God, it is a humbling thought to think that we have eyes watching our every move, because we fall short of your glory so often. So God, we pray your Spirit upon each and every one of us, your church and us, your followers, that through the power of your Spirit, we might display your love, your hope, and your active presence in everything we say and everything we do, so that no eyes that are watching may be forgotten, and that the future would be secure. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Celebrated into the second grade, a greenless child, gray among the orange and the yellows, attached too much to corners and to other people's sunshine. She colors the rainbow brown and leaves balloons unopened in their packages. Oh, who will touch this greenless child? who will plant alleluias in her heart and send her dancing into all of the colors of God? Or will she be left like an unwrapped package on the kitchen table, too dull for anyone to take the trouble? Does God think we're her keeper? Who will touch the greenless children and work to see that every child enters school ready to learn with strong early childhood experiences that are safe and nurturing? We will, with the grace of God. Who will believe and act on that belief that all children can succeed and perform at high levels? We will, with the grace of God. Who will work to support children, parents, teachers, and principals to make the best educational decisions possible? We will, with the grace of God. Who will see that children and schools have the resources they need to prepare every child to learn and succeed? We will, with the grace of God. Who will support quality teaching and let our teachers know that their work is valued? We will, with the grace of God. Who will support families in times of crisis so the needs of the children will not be neglected? We will, with the grace of God. Who will work to involve our whole community, healthcare providers, police, social service agencies, neighborhood groups, voluntary organizations, and other congregations to see that our children get what they need to learn and succeed in school and beyond? We will, with the grace of God. We are called to covenant with God and with one another. God will be with us as we help all children, especially the greenless children, to learn, succeed, and fulfill their God-given potential. Because Jesus, whom we seek to follow, loves all the children of the world, so shall we. Let us join together to sing.
In so many ways, so now let us give back but a portion of what God has already given to us and into our care. Would the ushers please come forward? Thank you.
Holy Lord, creator of all that fills our lives with joy, the gifts we bring to you are tokens of our gratitude. From your gracious hand, we have received peace, grace, hope, and love. May the gifts we bring result in other hearts coming to know the joy of your love. Amen.
In our time of prayer, we're going to use those objects that you grabbed when you came in, that you were offered when you came into the sanctuary. So as I lift each one, I would ask you to lift the one that you have. And just as a clue, we're starting with the crayon. Let us pray. Almighty God, the challenges facing children and those who care for them can seem so huge and so abstract that we lose touch with reality. Help us to remember that the needs and prayers of each child, each parent, each teacher, each caring person are as real and as individual to you as the items in our hands. And so we pray this day for the child care providers and parents who provide safe, warm, stimulating environments to spark a love of learning and fuel the curiosity of our youngest children as they scribble with crayons, pet the hamster, and try to taste the Play-Doh. We pray especially for those providers who are underpaid and undervalued, for those parents who can't find quality, affordable care for their children while they work, and for the children whose potential is squelched in poor care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Chalk. We pray for the teachers covered in chalk dust who devote themselves to educating our children and helping them flourish to their full potential. For their dedication, imagination, and concern, we give you thanks. We pray especially for those teachers who have given up on themselves or on the children they serve, those who feel unsafe, and those who feel unappreciated. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. A pencil. We pray for students gripping pencils as they strive to learn, especially those faced with the challenges of disability, unsafe schools, low expectations from their parents, teachers, and selves, and inadequate resources. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. A Band-Aid. We pray for children who are sick and injured, whose ability to learn is hampered by vision and hearing problems or illness. We pray especially for those children who do not have health insurance to get the care they need, and for their parents who worry about what to do, who rely on temporary solutions when prevention or treatment is needed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. A penny. We pray for the youths who are preparing for the world of work, that you will guide them in discovering their gifts and talents, skills and aptitudes, and surround them with teachers and adults who will get them ready to succeed. We pray especially for those young people who fear that they will not be able to find work and earn a living, who don't have adults to help them prepare, and who despair of ever succeeding. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Finally, the pen. We pray for our leaders in government, business, and the media that the laws they write, the bottom lines that are inked, and the stories they pen will demonstrate an investment and priority in our children today for our future tomorrow. Lord, in your mercy. Now, hear us as we pray the prayer your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. peace of God be with you.
And also with you. Brothers and sisters, now may God be in your head and in your understanding. May God be in your eyes and in your seeing. May God be in your ears and in your hearing. May God be in your mouth and in your speaking. May God be in your heart and in your knowing. May God be in your coming, but especially in your going. Go in peace. Amen.